No, we have to wake up. We have to respond to this. We are playing a very dangerous game. We have to wake up. If we don't take action, and if we don't stop using the sky as an open sewer for all of this heat-trapping pollution, this temperature increase will continue to go up. ...93% of all of the extra heat trapped by the global warming pollution goes into the oceans. And it doesn't stay in the oceans, it comes back and affects us in multiple ways. The warmer oceans also make the typhoons stronger. There are several ways that the warmer oceans caused by the climate crisis affects typhoons. They get more intense and they intensify much more rapidly. It used to be that a typhoon would start off small and then it would take a long time for it to get stronger. Now they get much stronger very quickly because the oceans have been heated up so much. And also, the warmer air holds a lot more moisture. I'll return to that fact in a few more minutes. But because it has much more moisture, the typhoons drop much more rainfall when they come across the land. Now let's talk about the water cycle, or the hydrological cycle. We all learned about this as young students in school. The evaporation off the ocean comes over the land and falls as precipitation, and then that water works its way back to the sea in a cycle. This cycle is being massively disrupted because the beginning of it is in the oceans, and because the oceans are warming up so much due to the global warming pollution, the amount of evaporation of water vapor into the sky is increasing quite significantly. There's a simple test. If you took a hot shower this morning, the sink, the mirror above the sink would steam up. If you took a cold shower, it doesn't happen. The warmer the air, the more moisture is in the air. And in fact, for each 1 degree increase in the air temperature, there is a 7% increase in the water vapor. That means the downpours get much, much larger. I could show you many images of downpours like this one that are just beyond the scale that was typical in the past. We get these enormous downpours. That all of these different climate-related disasters are getting steadily worse and more common. Asia has suffered the most of any part of the world. And last year, 30,000 people here in Korea were displaced because of extreme weather events. And the GDP here in Korea is suffering a great deal of damage, almost a 13% decline projected over the next quarter century if we do not take action. Now, I've talked about the downpours and the flooding events. The same extra heat that causes the evaporation of moisture into the sky also pulls the moisture out of the soil. So we get more droughts at the same time we get more flood. And let's talk about fire, because there is an almost exact correlation between higher temperatures and the incidence of fire. This was in Gangwon province, South Korea, March of a year ago. Hundreds of homes burned. This wildfire threatened a nuclear power station and a liquefied natural gas plant. And in Europe, this summer, we have seen wildfires burning in almost every nation in Europe. Just today in the Canary Islands in Tenerife, there are mass evacuations underway. And you may have seen some of the images from the fires in Portugal. This is the second round of fires this year in Portugal. Near Mount Etna in Sicily, they have had very serious fire damages, and this is near Athens. And the prime minister of Greece says the climate crisis is here. We are at war. And just last week in my country, we had a great tragedy on the beautiful scenic island of Maui. Perhaps you have read about it. More than 100 people have been found dead. There are 1,000 people still missing. And we pray for them and their families. It is such a horrible tragedy. More than 2,700 homes burned very, very quickly. Some people jumped into the ocean to escape the fire and then had to be rescued from the ocean. This is still a tragedy unfolding with this fire. It's happening all over the world. In California, last month, a few weeks ago, the York Fire burned 37,000 hectares. And by the way, today, in the Northwest Territories, the city of Yellowknife, everyone in the city is going through a mass evacuation today, right now, while we are meeting here in Korea. And at the same time, in British Columbia, Canada has had massive fires throughout this year. This is one in British Columbia just last month, and there are evacuations there as well. Here are the fires active now in Canada. And virtually every part of Canada has fires underway. Canada's CO2 emissions this year have doubled just because of the fires. And the impact on the people affected is growing. And the impact on their neighbors. This is New York City in June of this year. I live in Nashville, Tennessee. The smoke from the Canadian fires came all the way south to Tennessee as well. I say that not really as a joke, but in order to make a point. We cannot get used to it to the point where we say, oh, well, let's just keep on going about our business. We don't have to do anything. We'll just keep playing golf. No, we have to wake up. We have to respond to this. And you know, in so many countries, a lot of the elected leaders, I think of my own country, we've had some successes, but so many elected officials are very friendly with the fossil fuel companies and they don't want change. Where can change come from? From you, from the grassroots, especially from young people, but from all people who take the time to learn the truth and then feel the urgency in their hearts, in your hearts, to persuade your governments at the local level, at the provincial level, at the national level, to do something. Time is running out.